I never imagined I'd say this, but I think Iran's hostility to Israel can be summed up by the experience of a single Iranian wrestler named Ali Reza. A few days ago, Ali Reza was about to beat a Russian wrestler in a world championship, and then his coach ordered him to lose the match. The reason? Because in the next round, Ali Reza would have had to face an Israeli wrestler. You see, Iran forbids its athletes from competing against Israelis. Now, that's not surprising, given that the regime in Tehran calls for the destruction of all Israelis, the destruction of Israel. Now, that's not going to happen, I assure you. We won't let that happen. But in the meantime, it's the people of Iran who pay the price. When his coach told Ali Reza to throw the match, he said his whole world seemed to come to an end. Just imagine a government forbidding its athletes from competing against blacks, gays, or Arabs. Close your eyes and think about Ali Reza for a moment. He trained countless hours. He dreamed of becoming a world champion. But the Iranian regime would rather see its athletes lose than compete against Israelis. So I have an idea. This is an idea that will honor and inspire future Ali Rezas by promoting exactly the kind of coexistence and tolerance that Iran tries so hard to stamp out. I want you to film yourself playing a sport against someone of a different nationality, a different faith, or different color. I want you to compete like hell. We're all for competition. Then I want you to shake hands, go out for a drink together, and then upload this to the social media. I want you to show Iran's regime that hating others will never make you a champion. It only makes you a pathetic and insecure loser. Winners aren't afraid to show tolerance and respect. Ali Reza, I want you to know that the tyrants who made you take a fall will fall themselves. A regime that crushes the creative and competitive spirits of its people, that regime is doomed. So are those who threaten to destroy the Jewish state. They'll go down for the count.
Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, and welcome to the Booms and Bus Show, a weekly podcast of free markets, rabidly anti-socialist, rabidly anti-democrat, anti-democracy, anti-fascism, pro-free spirits, live and let live, and therefore, how can you possibly not be pro-Israel, the sole democracy from all of Europe through to India? I've had some numpties on Twitter tell me that Lebanon is a democracy, and they call me everything under the sun for not acknowledging the fact. I don't call them anything under the sun for not acknowledging the fact that, as it says in Wikipedia, in Lebanon, certain number of political places are reserved for certain religious entities. I wonder which religious entities we might be talking about. I also look at things which interest me, what's going on in the world. We talk about economics, we talk about markets. Do you know what? One of my prime motivations in the Booms and Bust show is to help you get yourself a bigger retirement fund. I'm not doing this trading lark, you know, buy this, sell that, all that kind of stuff. I'm not even giving advice. Anyone who takes what I say here for advice is in cloud cuckoo land. What I'm doing is giving pointers and telling you what's happening in markets, and suggesting that, you know, this is hot to trot or this is looking good. And I tend to look at things which are positive or negative, indeed, for the medium to long term. I'm not in the slightest interested in what's going to be good for the next nanosecond. So there was Prime Minister of Israel, Benjamin Netanyahu, truly great man. I'm not sure personally I would like the guy, but he's clearly a great man. He's an ex Defence Force hero. He went into politics. He's been Prime Minister for as long as I can imagine, of a country which has a strong opposition, and his party has just been winning for a long time. The Israeli economy is doing very well. There is relative peace in the sense that they're only getting hundreds of rockets launched in at them every year, from particularly Palestinian territories. That's relative peace because, of course, it's not all-out war with the whole of Arabia. And I think he's hit on a great point there. In fact, I tweeted about it a week or so ago, and then I saw that he did that short announcement on television about it. It's a great point. It's the essence of socialism and fascism that if you don't give people, individuals, the opportunity to grow, develop, compete and win, then you defeat a whole country, a whole population. And you relate that to something like the EU, where it's not looking for winners, it's looking for everyone to be dumbed down to the lowest common denominator, which is basically France. I know, of course, Germany's doing very well, but you get the point that I'm making. Sticking with European talk, the following countries are in Europe: Russia, Belarus, Armenia, Ukraine, Serbia, Switzerland, Moldova, Bosnia and Herzegovina, San Marino, Faroe Islands, Iceland, Georgia, Isle of Man, Montenegro, Liechtenstein, Jersey, Macedonia, Guernsey, Monaco, Turkey, Andorra and Norway. Do you know what they've all got in common? It's amazing! They're not in the EU. And well done to them for never getting involved. Imagine the UK was not in the single market and the customs union now, and we were invited to join on the terms that we do actually have, which means, for example, we pay them £9 billion a year. We accept endless regulations, free movement, European Court of Justice jurisdiction, etc. And of course, we don't have a seat on the World Trade Organization. We're probably going to lose, if we stay in the EU, our seat on the UN Security Council, and so on. Who in their right mind would campaign for a yes vote for us to join on the terms that we have? We absolutely have to leave the EU. I'll come back to EU economics in a mo. So it's December. In fact, it's December Tuesday the 5th that I'm recording this at about 11:15 on the morning. Normally, listener, you know I record and publish on a Monday afternoon, but I was absolutely up to here. I was swamped with things that I had to do and to do with my work, and I absolutely could not spare the time to do the show, which is a great shame because I absolutely love doing the show. I always say it's a great crack. I always have a blast doing it. And indeed, I'll tell you now, I want you to guess how many weekly downloads there are of the show. Now, bearing in mind, and I'm giving you some caveats, this little mini competition, this mini quiz, bearing in mind that basically no one knows me. So, you know, that's a fair point. No one knows me. I'm not some big hotshot media person that started a podcast, who comes from I don't know, London. It used to be on national radio and television for years and years and year, and already has a million followers or something like that on Twitter. No. And indeed, the Twitter account for the show is Booms Busts Show. I do hope that you're following Booms Bus Show on Twitter. If you're not, I would ask you to do so. So anyway, as I say, it's December. Starting to think about putting up a Christmas tree and the lights, which we wanted to do this weekend, but so many things were going on with the kids and, you know, all the rest of it, guides and the local village hall was doing so many things. We just didn't have time, even though we were planning to put the tree and the lights up. We just didn't get a chance to. We'll try and put some lights up during the week, and then we'll probably put the tree up at the weekend. But, you know, we should point out that the youth of today are, of course, all immature idiots. You know what? They still believe that a white-haired, bearded, jolly old bloke is going to give them loads of free stuff. It's going to be magically appear and never have to be paid for. Or as Jeremy Corbyn, as he likes to be called. Rail ticket prices are going up by about inflation from early January, as indeed they do every year, whether or not there's inflation. So think about that. We have the highest rail fares in Europe. That in itself, I don't think is a problem, because we know that all the other European countries are massively subsidised. So who's subsidising, and indeed subsidising our own trains? We're just paying a little bit more to use them and less subsidy. It's not the people who use them that are subsidising, it's the next generation who are subsidising, because it's coming from debt. It's coming from government debt. They're borrowing, they're subsidising rail fares, and who's going to pay for it? Not the people who are using the trains today, but the next generation. Is that fair? Is it hell? It's about winning votes. Also, what's about winning votes? Why also are rail fares going up 3.5% the early January? Because the train drivers got a 28% pay rise early in November 2017 to end the Southern Rail strikes. 28%. When you are a monopoly supplier of labour, you can take the buyers of your labour and treat them like monkeys, and especially when it's political, they always, always, always cave in. Bring back Maggie. So, you know, we're paying bigger rail fares so that some thousands of folk can get 28% wage rises. This is cronyism par excellence. Maggie would have told them where to go and would have put managers and temporary staff into the trains, and she would have brought forward as quickly as possible driverless trains. The technology is there. You do not need a driver. You know, socialist politicians are great at six things. I'm reading on Twitter. One, they're great at using nice-sounding, fluffy words. Two, breeding laws like flies. Three, wasting citizens' money. Four, infiltration institutions. In other words, they just poke their nose into everything and they don't let us just get on with our lives. Five, making more noise than their numbers warrant. And six, they're really great. I mean, seriously brilliant. They're Olympians at mass genocide. On this week in history, listener, on the 3rd of December 1992, so what's that, 25 years ago, the first SMS message was sent. Who invented it? Britain, of course. A British software engineer texted a Vodafone executive and he wrote, Merry Christmas. Did socialists invent SMS messaging? No, it was profit-seeking businesses and their engineering employees who invented SMS. Isn't it always the way? Profit-seeking free market capitalism helps the people. Socialism and cronyism helps the elite to the detriment of the people. On the subject of texting, in this time, this period of more booze drunk, more late nights, less work getting done, offices and factories closed down, listener, I just want you to look at your phone, look at your practices, and make sure that this Christmas you practice safe text. Make sure that you're wearing a rubber glove when you touch, when you hold, when you gently stroke your phone. I said I'd come back to European economics. It's looking good, listener. Forget what you hear and read from the likes of, I don't know, Max Kaiser, Zero Hedge, Mick Shedlock, Martin Armstrong, Peter Schiff, Mark Faber, what's his name from SocGen, Albert Edwards, oh my God, the doom and gloom merchants. This is the booms and busts show. When I was podcasting to you in the early part of 2016, I was telling you that it was entirely appropriate that the stock market had taken a kicking. Global trade year on year was the second worst since 1958. Purchasing manager industry indices were dire. We were seeing economic stats coming from Southeast Asia, -10, -20% year on year. But through 2016, a lot of things got a lot better. And now we're at the end practically of 2017 and we see the market, Eurozone manufacturing, purchasing manufacturer indices. Germany is standing at 62.5, an 81-month high. Let me remind you that above 50 is expansion, below 50 is contraction. The Netherlands, 62.4, a record high. Austria, 61.9, a record high. Italy, 58.3, also an 81-month high. Listen to this, listener. Ireland, a 58.1 index, a 215-month high. France, 57.7, 84-month high. Spain, 56.1, 129-month high. Even wasted, decrepit, sold down the river, going to the woodshed, Greece, 52.2 expansion, third month in a row, it's up. I'll come to the UK in a moment. Now, what's curious with all of that is Eurozone retail sales year on year to October, that's the most up-to-date stat, plus 0.4%. So what is all this manufacturing doing across the largest countries in Europe, in the EU, should I say? No, in the Eurozone, I beg your pardon. And yet the people aren't experiencing it. They're not buying a lot of stuff. So I wonder what's going on there. Just something to note. Now, as for the UK, literally came out today, 5th of December, market UK manufacturing PMI, listen to this, 58.2 in November 2017, a 51-month high. Output, new orders and employment in manufacturing, which, okay, is only a sixth of the economy. Output, new orders and employment in manufacturing all rise faster than previously. Investment goods new orders increase at the steepest pace since August 1994. This is fantastic. That's the manufacturing, which, as I say, is only about 17-18% of the UK economy. So what about the overall economy? The market composite PMI, which includes services, which I say is by far the bulk of the UK economy, 54.9, still strong expansion. But you know what? Most of the countries I've mentioned are immaterial. The only one there that probably is of interest is Germany, but you know what's far more of interest is what's going on in America and China. If you want to know what's going on in the global economy, look at America, China, and yes, okay, Germany. But, you know, if you know China, you're basically going to know Germany, because so much of German manufacturing is exported to China. America is going to grow 3 or 4%. Over the next year. China's composite PMI, 51.6. Previous month, 51.0. It's in expansion and it's getting faster. China is an expansion. That's really all you need to know. And by the way, that's why Germany is still in expansion. Interesting. You know, I've talked for months off and on about the UK car market, and I talked a lot about the American car market, how it's falling on its knees. And I've said for months that the UK was 3 to 6 months behind the US. So the Society of Motor Manufacturers and Traders came out with their monthly stats. The UK new car market declined for an eighth consecutive month in November, and largely driven by, did you see what I did there? A significant fall in diesel sales. Well, no blooming wonder when you get the likes of this, Merton Council charging £90 a year for a residential parking permit for a petrol car. If you've got diesel, it's literally double. It's not to do with clean air. Modern diesels are perfectly clean relative to the environment. It's nothing to do with that. It's all about taxes and finding ways to do it politically palatably. And that's the reason why people are turning away from diesel. So the net change, a fall of 5%, and with diesel, it's actually a fall of 16%. What's fascinating, and we'll come back to this over the weeks and months, I have no doubt whatsoever, is that the percentage increase in sales of alternative fueled vehicles, largely electric, up 34.6%. They've now got a 4.7% market share. Last year it was a 3.3% market share. Very, very interesting. Now, moving on, Oxford University is putting out to the city, it hasn't happened yet, but it will happen soon, its first ever bond. In other words, it wants to borrow money from pension funds, hedge funds, sovereign wealth funds, and so on. And it wants to borrow for £100 years. And think about that. Let's say that it takes this debt on, I don't know, let's say it's the 2nd of January at 2018. It doesn't have to repay it until the 2nd of January 2118. I mean, really, when you think about it, anyone who would have loaned money to a government or some kind of a large institution 100 years ago, just think how incredibly devalued that loan is now. The price of money went down literally about 99% over the last century, thanks largely to the Federal Reserve of the US. So anyone lending money to an institution for 100 years now, whatever the interest rate, even if it's something astonishing like, I don't know, 10% a year, are they really going to be sufficiently compensated for what is likely to be the value, the repayment of the loan in 2118? I highly doubt it. The bond, which is expected to raise at least £250 million, will have the longest duration of its kind. And it's interesting because it's to lend money to Oxford University. And we see that last year, $1.8 billion, which I guess is about £1.4 billion, was borrowed by UK universities and schools, I presume that's independent schools, and from 2008 to 2011, it was zero. So from 2012, it's really been ramping up how much these guys are borrowing, bearing in mind that the universities charge £9,000 a year, more debt, by all these kids taking these degrees that aren't worth the paper they're written on. Last year, the biggest loan was to Cardiff University, £300 million over 30 years at merely 3.1%. So the lenders believe that in 30 years' time, they will have been compensated by being paid 3.1%. And the value of their loan will basically be the same in 30 years as it is today, because 3.1% is about inflation. I just find that remarkable. I can't believe that. I mean, these people are incredibly stupid. That's the reason, listener, why the people who work in universities are earning fortunes. You've just had the announcement of the resignation of Bath University's vice chancellor because her total package was getting on for £500,000 a year. Actually, she's not going to leave until, I believe, it's either late next year or early 2019, so she's laughing all the way to the bank. And some of these vice chancellors, I don't think there's one earning less now than £300,000 a year total package. And if they're earning between £300,000 and £500,000 a year, it means the deputy vice-chancellors are earning not much less. Then you've got the other executives. Then you've got the professors, the department heads. It is an absolute con. And the next generation are paying for it left, right and centre. And these academics have the audacity to be socialists. It just makes me sick. So why is that relevant to economics? Because I'm talking there about long-term borrowing, long-term debt. And the idea that in 30 or in ridiculous case, 100 years, loans will not have devalued left, right and centre, so the ultimate recipient of the loan repayment will just not be paid back in decent value of money. And we look at market interest rates. In America, the one-year Treasury yield, the rate at which the US government borrows over a 12-month period, has just climbed to the highest level in 9 years. In fact, to pre-crash levels at 1.66%. So if the US government's borrowing money now over a 12-month period, they have to pay 1 2/3%. Compare that to their base rate, which is 1%. So that suggests that the market is saying the base rate is too low. Indeed, the futures markets, because, you know, the actual markets are only open in the US from 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. In the afternoon in New York time, and in UK time, that's 2:30 to 9 p.m. So the futures markets, because many of these assets are actually traded more or less 24/5, not at the weekend, and the futures are forecasting strongly a 0.25% interest rate rise next week. 0.25% interest rate rise in March, and 0.25% interest rate rise next September. So that will indeed take the base rate in the US to 1.75%. Hence why the 1-year Treasury yield is already now at 1.66%. Remember, the central banks never lead the markets. It's always the other way around. The 1-year rate is nearly 1.7%. The markets are forecasting that the Fed will take the funds rate, which is effectively the bank base rate, to about that level in the later part of next year. Hence, the market moves first. And I'll tell you something, though. These levels, these anticipated levels of 1.75%, sort of in 9 months' time, they're still too low. They're too low for an economy that is now over eight years in expansion. It's only got 4.1% unemployment, 85 straight months of payroll numbers growth, consumer confidence at a 17-year high, the stock market's at a 9-year high, in fact, an all-time high. House prices are outpacing inflation and at record highs. No, I think we can reasonably expect interest rates to be rising faster. But it just shows you the relatively glacially slow pace at which rates are rising relative to inflation. Inflation 2 years was practically zero. It's now 3 or 4. Interest rates 2 years ago was practically zero. It's now 1%. And indeed in the UK, it's merely 0.5%. And they're unmoved in the EU, in the Eurozone, and in Japan. So interest rates always, A, follow what the market does, and the market, B, follows what inflation does. And I've been talking about inflation a lot. So it's nigh on crazy that you've, going back to what I was saying earlier, that you've got the Eurozone economy so strong, and yet the ECB is still at a negative interest rate. And still doing quantitative easing, money printing. I mean, it's beyond criminality. Moving on to the markets. I see last week that the oil company, the oil giant Shell, confirmed the rumours that it will be announcing firm plans for share buybacks between, well, now and 2020 in the sum of $25 billion, circa 19 or 20 billion pounds over a circa 3-year period. That's enormous, isn't it? 6 or 7 billion pounds coming into the market from that one company alone. You know, When you listen to the idiots who are always calling doom and gloom, and they can't understand why equities are doing so well and so on, there are very good reasons why the markets are so strong. This is not a judgment call as to whether or not they should be so strong, but you can at least see reasons why. I'm the first, as you've heard a number of times, me to say, you know, nobody should believe the reasons. I'm just saying there are reasons which are believable. And no doubt there will be other energy companies announcing such share buybacks. Why? Because they're creating so much cash now that oil is doing so well. And I tell you what, I bet natural gas is going to be hot to trot as well. I think it's going to go through the roof. So energy companies generally, share prices, they've been on a tear. We held from... let me think. We bought into global energy shares in the early to middle of 2015. Oil kept on falling. Energy shares kept on falling, but we bought at a discount of about 40% from the all-time highs in global energy shares. And we topped up our global energy shares in November of 2016. And if I remember, I'll do a chart of global energy. They've been on a tear. And given what I've been saying about oil probably going to $75 by early 19, I think global energy, I'm delighted to hold it, and we'll continue to do so. There is a chart of the global stocks index. So stocks in general, not energy, not technology, not consumer, just stocks in general. And do you see that that candlestick on the right-hand side? I suggest to you, Milud, that is a hanging man candle. Look it up on Google. Hanging man candlestick, it's potentially bearish. Does that mean that the market is falling apart? No, not in the slightest. But I think at least we can reasonably expect a revisit to the red line, which is the 50-day moving average. I've been saying a correction is due. I wouldn't at all be surprised to see it go down to the 200-day. It's had a brilliant run, global shares. I mean, that's only a... about a 5-month chart. Global shares have had amazing runs over the last couple of years. A significant breather would not at all be untoward. And indeed, the RSI suggests it because it's seeing lower highs. The high on the RSI in October, a lower high in November, a lower high again in December. In November again. If we don't see us getting back above the 70 level, then yes, we're looking at a correction. It might only be to the 50-day, so practically nothing at all. It might be more serious back to the 200-day, but even then, you're looking at an index going from 72 to 67. What's that? Not even 10%. So nothing to be concerned about. But, you know, to add fuel to that fire, we had an interesting thing happen yesterday. And by the way, that candlestick is that red one there was the candle of Friday. What happened in the S&P yesterday, Monday the 4th of December, was very interesting. You had the futures market, which had gapped up from Friday on Sunday night, up over 0.5%. So nothing major about that. It happens a lot. And during the trading day yesterday, Monday, it traded to a multi-year high. But you know what? The price then reversed during the day and closed at UK time 9 p.m. New York time, 4 p.m., it closed down on the day. So I'll repeat that. It gapped up in the futures market on Sunday night. It traded higher to multi-year highs during the day, and then it reversed somewhat sharply and closed negative compared to the Friday closing price. The last time that scenario occurred was January the 3rd, 2000. Now, I'm thinking right in saying that the markets didn't peak until March, April of 2000, the NASDAQ at least. The S&P might have been earlier or later, but March and April was a major peak, I know. And then it finally troughed in March of 2003. So, you know, it's very interesting that that one event happened, and we've got to watch because, you know, that's an extremely unusual event, clearly. It hasn't happened in literally 17 and a half years. Something to watch for. And let's face it, the markets are up, not in a straight line for 9 years. Although, you know, I've said before and I say it again, what is more likely is we started a new bull market in early 16. But if the market gods decide that this year we see a peak, well, we'll be looking for lower highs, and we'll see for the technical indicators trading trending down on a weekly and indeed monthly chart basis. So just to remind you, my name is Jonathan Davis. This is the Booms and Bust Show. I've got a little quiz out to you. And that quiz is how many people do you think download the show? Why don't you respond to my tweet on that with your guesses? It's probably not as much as you might initially have thought, but I can say I'm delighted that we got past a milestone and we got a record high number of downloads for any of the shows since we started in March this year. So that's obviously fantastic. As I say, the Twitter account is Booms Busts Show. If you haven't found me there, do have a look and follow. When I tweet about the show, this particular podcast, click on the tweet, scroll down, and you'll see charts and pictures there, which I've been talking about in the show. It'd be great if you could retweet the tweet of the show. I think we got 9 retweets last couple of weeks. Let's see if we can get 10 retweets this week. That would be lovely. I'd really appreciate it. And indeed, as I say, if you could possibly click on the iTunes link, which is right there, if you just scroll down. And all I'm asking you to do is just star rate the show. That's all I'm asking you to do. If you want to leave a review as well, fantastic. Just star rate the show. I know a few of you have in recent weeks. Thank you so, so much. Indeed, thank you, the 9 guys and girls who have been retweeting the show. And I know you do it regularly, almost religiously every week. Thank you so, so much. But, you know, it's not about me. It's about these messages. It's about getting it out to other people. You know, let's share the love, as they say in Radio 1 land. Anyone with grey hairs who's in the UK will know what I mean by that. The Booms and Busts report, something I put out every couple of months. I sent that out last week. If you want it, if you're not on the mailing list, just send me your email address to jd@theboomsandbustsshow.com. jd@theboomsandbustsshow.com. Just send me your email address and your name, and I'll put you in the list. I guarantee you, you'll never be junk mailed. I'm practically at the end of the show. I've got a couple of sort of quotes, kind of things I want to mention. Firstly, from the great free market economist Milton Friedman. Keep your eye on one thing and one thing only. How much government is spending? Because that's the true tax. If you're not paying for it in the form of explicit taxes, you're paying for it indirectly in the form of inflation or borrowing. Couldn't put it any better myself, Mr. Friedman. Genius. And listener, you know, when you think about the world and where we're headed, and you see all these so-called anti-fascists who are themselves the fascists, because closing down free speech is the first tenet of fascism. Just remember the following in relation to what I just said there from Milton Friedman. 1930s fascism was popular because it promised jobs and security through spending large amounts of money raised by taxes and government borrowing. Now, just to finish off this week's show, tell you about something that happened to me last week. A bit of fun and games. I want to say, first of all, thank you to all those who tweeted and emailed me and wished me well, and to check that I'm okay. I am okay. The result, first of all, is that I ended up with literally just cuts and bruises and no harm done, really, to person or any property. So my wife and daughters were in her car last Tuesday early evening, and she phoned me up. I've had a burst tire. Okay, so I go out, it's probably a few miles, I go and find them, they come into my car, lock up her car, and I bring them home, take the elder one to guides. And then from there, I went back to the car, which was on a B road in practically the middle of nowhere, with no lighting, in order to change the tyre, or so he thought. So the tyre in question was the near side rear, and I parked my car behind my wife's. Kept the engine running like the recovery guys do, and had the lights on, dip beam, so I could see what I was doing. And I loosened all of the bolts, including the security nut thingy. I was able to loosen that bolt, so that was going well. I slid the jack under the car, and started turning the thing to make the jack expand and then raise the car. And if you've ever done this, you'll know that until the jack gets tight with the car, the scissor part can actually swivel around a lot. So with my left hand, I was holding onto the swivel, onto the scissor part, and trying to turn with my right hand, which was not actually so easy. And would you know it, suddenly, with no fanfare, no indication that this was about to happen, the jack suddenly slipped, and the car trapped my left hand into the car jack. So the whole weight of the car was onto my left hand, and largely my three middle fingers, and crushed into the metal of the car jack. Well, you know, it was very painful. Astonishingly, it wasn't extremely painful. And, you know, what on earth am I going to do? Well, of course, the first thing I do is I reach for my phone. And all I can say is, thank goodness, my phone was in my coat pocket. Because imagine the abject, extreme despair if I knew that my phone was in my car, like 10 feet away, but there was absolutely no way I could get to it. But it was in my pocket. It did have battery power, and I did have a signal. Now, as you can imagine, I didn't quite think straight. I phoned my wife, who was at home with one of our children, and I said, phone the emergency services. This is what's happened. I need help now. So I'm sitting there, or crouching down to be exact, in quite a lot of pain, in exasperation and desperation, because I can't move, and, you know, it's somewhat claustrophobic in that sense. And so after a couple of minutes, I phone her back, but she's engaged. After another minute, I phone her back. She's engaged. So I'm, you know, what on earth is going on? So 5 minutes later, she's still blooming well engaged. So I thought, I don't know what's going on here. I've got no confirmation. There's a couple of times for a few seconds that I was a little bit frightened. I used the phone to soothe that by phoning her. But of course, each time I phoned her, she was engaged. And would you believe it, by this time, a couple of cars had driven past me. And I was waving my right arm. I was looking at them. I was shouting at the top of my voice, help. And they drove right past and didn't look back. So, wonderful. So I phoned 999 myself. And I got through to an absolute numpty of a fire service call handler. Three times I had to ask her, are they on their way? And three times her robotic response was, they'll be there as soon as they can, sir. Eventually, I was able to summon up the brain power to say, madam, I'm asking you a specific question. Are they on their way? To which she said, sorry, not are they on their way? Can you see where they are on your screen? And she said, no, we don't have that technology. All I can tell you is they'll be there as soon as they can be. And they're coming from, and it was the local town about 2 miles away. So, fair enough, I knew they weren't going to be long, and indeed, by the time I finished that call, I'd actually heard a siren. They were trying to get past someone on the road. I also spoke to an ambulance call handler who was so abjectly bad and unhelpful, I actually said to her, if you continue like this, I'm going to have to put the phone down. I had to put the phone down on her. She was so bad. The actual guys who turned up, however, were absolutely 10 out of 10. In fact, even 11 out of 10. Astonishingly, apparently because there's a person involved, there was two fire engines and a team of guys and a fire boss in his car, astonishingly. And of course, as soon as the first guys came to me, I was able to tell them what the score was, just two of them. Quick lift up of the car, the jack fell down, my hand was free. Well, you can imagine the relief that I had after 20 minutes of that. They did some quick paramedicing on me. It was pretty obvious. I probably didn't have a broken bone. I had big bruises, big cuts, Blood. It wasn't pretty. It was painful. There was a ridge into the finger where clearly a cylindrical piece of metal had been pressing down for all that time. Then the actual ambulance turned up eventually, and the paramedic, he did my blood pressure, he did my my pulse. He was asking me lots of questions, doing a great job. I was sitting down in the passenger seat. And after a few minutes, I stood up, and the fire guys had been talking amongst themselves what they're going to be doing. And one of the senior guys turned to me and said, "So what we're going to do, sir, is we're going to change your tire for you. Can you believe it?" I actually said to him, "You're going to do what?" He said, "Yeah, if that's okay with you." I said, "Yes, it's definitely okay with me. Thank you so, so much." It was incredible. They changed my tire. Can you believe it? And then when I was sitting in the ambulance and they were doing some tests on me, he came back, opened the door and said, with your permission, because this side road here is famous for naughty things happening to cars, which are lying around, we're going to drive it to the fire station. Well, you know, I was aghast and beyond delighted. It was astonishing. The guys were amazing. So the firefighters and the ambulance paramedics were 10 out of 10, indeed 11 out of 10. The two call handlers, and remember, my wife spoke to both the same call handler at the ambulance and at the fire as I did, because, you know, there's a room, and it just so happens we got through to the same two people. They were both absolutely awful. Listen to this about the ambulance call handler. The reason why my wife was on hold all the time, well, first of all, it took a minute to be put through to ambulance. She should actually have been put through to fire service first of all. Huh. So that also meant I was there for an extra 5 minutes, which I shouldn't have been. If the fire guys had been called 5 minutes earlier, however, she got through to this numpty woman, the call handler for the ambulance, who asked her the most inane questions. Now think about this. 3 minutes into the conversation, the ambulance had not yet been sent off. First point. Second point. She asked my wife from a list of questions, "Is he still breathing?" She knew that the car had gone onto my hand. At worst, I lost some fingers. Secondly, 3 minutes into the conversation, she asked, "Am I still breathing?" Isn't that the question you ask first or second? Now, there is no doubt in my mind that those call handlers were atrocious, partly because they themselves were atrocious and robotic, partly also, of course, because the system is clearly dreadful. So, as Angry of Tunbridge Wells would say, someone should do something. Well, I talked to someone who's actually in a local authority, and he said, "You know what? You should write to the chief fire officer, tell them how wonderful his guys were. But by the way, you should know about this, and let him have a look at it and see whether or not he wants to take it on board." So I might well do that. But literally, I was sitting down in front of the fireman, paramedic. I was able to move my fingers. My pulse was already starting to slow back down again. And I knew that I was okay. I drove. I've got an automatic car. I drove to that local hospital. It's 2 miles away. Within half an hour, I had an X-ray. No broken bones. I am a very lucky boy. The firefighters were magnificent. The paramedics were magnificent. The local hospital accident and emergency was magnificent. They did a great cleaning job. I was in and out within an hour. And of course, they've got other people to deal with. I'm a very, very lucky boy. I had my phone. It had a signal. Goodness knows, if I didn't have my phone in my pocket, my wife didn't have a car. She couldn't speak to me. It would probably have been well over an hour before she thought to find out what's going on with me. And then when she couldn't get through to me, it might have been another hour before she phoned anyone. Because otherwise, I'm a very, very lucky boy. I could have been there for hours. Oh, by the way, that reminds me. One of the other things this numpty ambulance woman said to my wife, we're sending an ambulance out, but you should know it's not an emergency. It may be ours. It's not an emergency? A car is trapping my fingers into metal, 1.5 tons, and it's not an emergency? This does not strike me as appropriate. As ever, I've had an absolute blast. I'll see you next week.